Good morning, church. If some of you in person or online are saying, wow, Paul looks so much more handsome today, it's because I'm trying to do my best Steve impersonation. Steve Brandt was scheduled to do this job today, but he asked me to fill in for him, so here I am. I've been very thankful the last few weeks that the youth has shown up for my Sunday school class. I thought I might just be alone eating my own snacks, but I'm glad to share them with all of them coming. And I'm going to let you all in on a little preview of what we're doing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say something, a question, a verse. This will just be 2 minutes. And I'm just going to pause to let you think of it. I tell them, I don't need answers. I just need to see that your brains are thinking. So are you guys ready for it? Okay, I'll take that as a yes. And parents, you might be getting these questions at home this week, so be prepared. Do you want there to be a God? What would be some reasons for someone to not believe in God? Are you on a happiness quest or on a truth quest? If Christianity were true, would you be a Christian? Do we just believe what we want to believe? Are people who live that way living a happier life? And our quote of the day is this from Wesley Huff. The Christian journey is not an endless search of humanity trying to find God, but it is about a God who has revealed himself to humanity. True or false? Matthew 11, 29 to 30. Accept my teachings and learn from me, because I am gentle and humble in spirit, and you will find rest for your lives. The burden I ask you to accept is easy. The load I give you to carry is light. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that we can gather together in your house, and that we as your people, people who are deeply in love with you, people who question if you're real, people who are curious, who is this Jesus, and why has he had such an impact in history and culture, and when he wasn't a worldly king, he wasn't a military leader. Who is this Jesus? Help us to prepare our hearts now as we worship, as we listen to your word, as Jacob shares with us. We ask for your spirit of truth to convict us and lead us to know you better. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to stand as we're going to continue singing together with This Is Amazing Grace.
Power of the power of sin and darkness, first love is mighty. Thank you.
You be seated.
If you don't know who I am, I'm Rob Shipman. I am the chair of the church council. And you may also be aware that October is Pastor Appreciation Month. In the foyer, we've had a couple of boxes set up with encouragement cards for our pastors, and you guys have been filling them out and stuffing the boxes, which is really good. We will continue to have those encouragement cards out through this week and next Sunday as well, but we're going to give the boxes to our pastors today, so you can just put those encouragement cards in their mailbox if you haven't done that yet. But we'd also like to just take an opportunity to formally acknowledge the work they do and how much we appreciate them. So I'm going to call Pastor Jacob and Pastor Paul up, if they can come up for a short second. You may notice Paul almost never comes up empty-handed. We just have a couple of cards here for you guys to just express how much we appreciate the work you do and your leadership. And there's a couple of gift cards in there as well, so you can go have a nice meal at a restaurant. And there's a couple other cards there too, so that you can maybe get yourself something at the Bay or maybe Cabela's. So once again, on behalf of all of us at Morrow, we just want to express our appreciation to both of you for the work you do, and to your wives as well, because they do an awful lot of work. So thank you very much.
No, that's okay. Thank you. So for our sermon series lately, we've been going through Colossians. And how Paul keeps leading us always to Jesus as such a central focus for us. So I thought it'd be interesting this morning to read the prayer of Jesus in John 17, right before his betrayal and arrest. I do encourage you all on the bulletin that are at tables at the back. We have a list of prayer items of some people and just some things to pray during the week. So I do encourage you to do that. So you can follow along with me if you want. John 17. After saying all these things, Jesus looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so he can give glory back to you. For you have given him authority over everyone. He gives eternal life to each one of you, each one you have given him. And this is the way to have eternal life, to know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, the one you sent to earth. I brought glory to you here on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. Now, Father, bring me into the glory we shared before the world began. I have revealed you to the ones you gave me from this world. They were always yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know everything I have is a gift from you. For I have passed on to them the message you gave me. They accepted it and know that I came from you. And they believed you sent me. My prayer is not for the world, but for those you have given me, because they belong to you. All who are mine belong to you, and you have given them to me, so they bring me glory. Now I am departing from the world. They are staying in this world, but I am coming to you, Holy Father. You have given me your name. Now protect them by the power of your name so that they will be united just as we are. During my time here, I protected them by the power of the name you gave me. I guarded them so that no one was lost except the one headed for destruction, as the scriptures foretold. Now I am coming to you. I told them many things while I was with them in this world so they would be filled with my joy. I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them, so they can be made holy by your truth. I am praying not only for those disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us, so the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, and they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. Father, I want these whom you have given me to be with me where I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you love me even before the world began. O righteous Father, the world doesn't know you, but I do. And these disciples know you sent me. I have revealed you to them, and I will continue to do so. Then your love will be made, then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to stand as we can continue singing together with God. You're so good.
With power. Thank you, worship team, Paul, and all of you for participating in this worship service. Pastor Paul and I know that in this last season, many pastors have been under increased criticism and sometimes attacks. And these have sometimes come from loved ones within their own congregation. We are so grateful that you have been gracious and kind, and in this trying season of these last 2 years, instead of becoming critical, you have stepped it up in encouragement and an affirmation and an appreciation. I speak for Pastor Paul and myself and Andrea, the staff here. Every week we rejoice in the people that we get to serve with. And we want to thank you for all that you have done for us and for the daily prayers that you pray on our behalf. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So, got that out of the way. Paul, can you say an amen to that? Amen. No, that's all. There we go. So, thank you. This morning, for those of that are online, and I want to just say thank you for so many of you that are faithfully watching online for various reasons, and some of you are newer to our congregation and you're joining us through the streaming, and we are grateful for that. This morning, we regret that you will have a little commercial break for the next 5 minutes, and then we'll resume the streaming. We're gonna stop the streaming because this morning we have a report from a young lady that is going to one of those more sensitive, restricted areas. And for concern for her safety, but also the effectiveness for her ministry in the coming years, we will not stream this, but I'll ask her to come forward. And so the streaming will stop, but the streaming will resume at about 5 minutes.
Scripture reading this morning is from Colossians chapter 3. I'm reading the first 11 verses of Colossians chapter 3, if you want to follow along. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. So put to death the sinful earthly things lurking with you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, For a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Because of these sins, the anger of God is coming. You used to do these things when your life was still part of the world, but now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. Don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old sinful nature and all its wicked deeds. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. In this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric, uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters, and He lives in all of us. Thus far.
Thank you, Jim, for the reading. And here's our sermon. A little more than a decade ago, evangelical theologian Michael Horton said, Barna and Gallup hand us survey after survey demonstrating that the evangelical Christians are as likely to embrace lifestyles every bit as hedonistic, materialistic, self-centered, and sexually immoral as the world in general. The pandemic has shown us that we can indeed be mean-spirited, defiant, and divisive. But we don't have to look beyond our own lives to note areas that are not yet in line with the gospel. Anger issues, anxiety, self-righteous critical spirit, a struggle with pornography or gluttony, or just plain selfishness. When we began this letter, one of the first chapters was Colossians chapter 1, verse 6. The gospel throughout the world, as we are reminded of this morning, is bearing fruit and changing lives. And I don't know when you read that, occasionally I wonder, is it still changing lives? Or has the gospel lost its power to change, to actually bring about transformation and change in people's lives? One of the people that I read a lot, he said that there are two reasons why people don't change. We believe we can't. And we believe this because we've tried and failed. In fact, this happens repeatedly, and so I know it's true. I try to change, and I can't, and I keep doing what I don't want to do, and so I know I can't change. It gets reinforced all the time. Or secondly, we don't want to change. Augustine admits that he prayed, "Give me chastity, but not yet." Our text today started with, since then, or since you have been raised to new life. And it's very closely connected to the verse that we left off last week, which said, but they provide no help in conquering a person's evil desires. And then he follows up with, since then. He was talking about the religious, external things that we seek to do. Fasting and depriving ourselves of certain things, all of those have no real power to conquer a person's evil desires. And so I think it might be correct for us to assume that what follows now should be some recipe for actually conquering those evil desires, of winning that battle that we struggle with. I do believe that the truth from our scripture today can set us free from both the I can't change and the I don't want to change prison. Now, since then, it's connected to the previous statement, but it's also connected to the previous two chapters in Colossians. So often, and I'll confess to this, that we jump to chapter 3. Put off the old self. Put on the new. Do this. Don't do that. And all of that is burdensome and impossible unless it flows from what we have dwelt in chapters 1 and 2. The profound and powerful truth is that our life is now bound up with Christ. Verse 4, and Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world. You will share in all his glory. One of the things that is so prevalent in the book of Colossians is how our life, those of us who believe, is now interconnected with Christ. With his death, you died with Christ. You are also raised with Christ. In Christ, you have a new purpose. In Christ, you are fully forgiven. In Christ, he has broken the power of sin over you. And in our text today, he finishes off with, in this life, it doesn't matter if you are Jew or Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric or civilized, slave or free, Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, this means that whoever belongs to Christ has become a new person. Or the NIV would say, has become a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. The NLT says, the old life is gone, a new life has begun. One of the things we don't realize in the Western world so much is that in Christianity, in its earlier roots, one of the key images was not just the cross, but was also the butterfly. And it was that image of transformation through the resurrection. And I think that it is time, especially for the angelical world, to grasp that image of the butterfly. And I'll tell you why in the rest of the sermon. Change is possible because of this reality. A change comes when we learn to live in the reality that we've been talking about in these first two chapters. Michael DeFazio, a beautiful Italian name, and some of you have been watching his lectures, says that our efforts are rooted in Christ's finished work, our efforts for change. It doesn't mean that there is no effort on our part, but it flows out of our relationship with and in Christ. The text for next Sunday, for the next few Sundays, will be about this great exchange, taking off the old, which is from below, and putting on the new, which is from above, and is in line with our new, our true self. Our text today is very important because before we get to any of that instruction, we have this instruction for change or exchange. And the first is that we change our heart and our mind. I want to dwell especially on the mind. The NIV says, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your hearts on the things that are above, where Christ is seated. Set your minds on the things above and not on earthly things. The NLT says, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. I had deleted it, but I'm going to insert it anyway. I've been trying to change what influences my thinking over the last while. It's been a little bit less CBC news and other news outlets, and a little bit more Christian radio. And then I get introduced to new songs. And one of the songs, I was pulling up to the church here, And it was a song by a group from a bunch of young men from Edmonton, a group called West From Here. And they have a song called Mortals. It's a fascinating song, but it wasn't at first because it wasn't really my style. But I was intrigued by the words. And the words were about how, oh, no, I deleted it. I wasn't going to tell you. Well, I'll send it out this week. But it has to do with we are mortals, finished with living life in the normal. We are mortals looking for portals, seizing portals of the eternal. And I love that image. And that is what Paul is talking about here. We are mortals still living in this earth, but what we are really fixing our eyes on are the things that are beyond this wall. We are fixing our eyes on the things that are eternal, the things that we cannot see yet, but that will one day be clear and real for us. But we already choose to live in that reality. And so we continue to look for those doorways, those pathways, those glimpses of heaven where Christ is. And one of the truths is that that is so key for what we're going to talk about next, is a behavior change. Before we are asked to change our behavior, we are asked to change our thinking. Our behavior, we all know this, flows from our thinking. Dallas Willard suggests that the path for spiritual formation comes firstly from having a vision of a new reality. A vision of a new reality. Then the intention to live in that reality. And thirdly, it follows by with a practical means. The acronym is VIM, like that bathroom cleaner. Vision, intention, and means. That's how formation happens, spiritual formation. And in the coming weeks, the Apostle Paul and Pastor Paul will paint a vision, a picture of what this new kingdom community looks like. In becoming flesh, God gave us a clear glimpse of what it looks like to be truly human. Our text is calling us to fix our eyes and our affections on Jesus and the things of God. Be renewed, verse 10. Be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. That is how the renewal in our lives happens. And this is the first step in spiritual formation. So I want to give you a little bit of application right off the bat. I invite you this week to make a list of key things that you believe to be true. Make a list of key things that you believe to be true. What do you believe about God? To be true of God? About Jesus? What do you believe to be true about living life well, and of dying well? What do you believe about life after this life? What do you believe to be true? And then throughout the day and the week, note what is shaping your thinking. The news, the movies, the music, the friends, the social media. And then ask yourself, what filters do you have in place to catch the lies that don't line up with what you truly believe? What do you truly believe? What is your information intake? And what filters do you have in place that filter out the lies that would seek to influence your thinking? What might you do to take in more things that support what you truly believe? Our thinking is always under attack. Somebody is always trying to change our mind. What filters do we have in place? Colossians chapter 3, verse 16 says this, "Let the message of Christ in all its richness fill your lives." I'll let Paul go further with that next week. Out of our new thinking flow new attitudes and actions. And I won't go into this in detail this week, but our thinking, we're asked to change what we focus on and what we think about. And then we are asked to exchange our behavior. And their list is long in these next verses. And it's all about taking off what no longer belongs and putting on what belongs to our new life in Christ. I made an observation this week after somebody prompted my thinking in that direction. That just as it is true that our thinking influences our behavior, it's also true that our behavior reinforces our thinking. Are you with me? Our thinking influences our behavior, but our behavior also reinforces our thinking. If I think I'm a putz, and then I do putzy things, and then I say, of course I'm a putz, look what I just did. It reinforced my thinking. Or whatever, maybe that wasn't a good word to use in church, but whatever that is, if we think that's who I am, and then I act out of that in accordance to what I think, and then I say, of course I'm that because I just acted according to that. And many Christians get stuck in exactly that. I am a sinner. And with this idea that I will only be perfect or only be conquered sin, I will only be transformed in that future by and by. And so this is what I grovel in. I'm a sinner saved by grace. Yes, fully grace, but also saved towards sanctification. So how we think about ourselves influences our thinking and our acting, and then that reinforces how we think. And the opposite is also true. How did I write it here? The opposite is also true. If I believe and understand that I am a new creation in Christ, that I've been set free from the bondage of sin, then when I am at that crossroad, because of Christ, I now have a choice. I can act like that, but because of Christ, I can also choose to act like this. I can respond like this, but because of Christ, I also have an alternative to respond in a different way. And when I respond in the different way, in the way that is from above, and the way that is good, then I go, oh. When I do choose the good, it reinforces that I am free to choose and that the good is good. Let me explain that a little bit further. Our behavior flows out of our thinking. Our behavior reinforces our thinking. And this is my application, my thought for you in this now. One of the things that I am finding helpful in my journey of transformation is the intentional reflection at the end of the day. And I sometimes do this together with Arlene, and sometimes I do it all by myself. But at the end of the day, I'm learning not just to hit the pillow and fall asleep, but to take some time to reflect on what has happened the day. How have I lived the day? What have I experienced? And I ask myself some of these questions. They're not always the same, but they flow along these lines of, where or how did I experience joy today? Where or how did I experience joy today? That question alone does a lot in creating a self-awareness. Where do I find joy? What truly gives me joy? It's this journey of self-discovery. I sometimes ask myself, how was I able to give or to receive love this day? Where or how was I able to give or to receive love today? In which moments did I feel off center? in which moment did I feel off-center or not truly myself? Which choices do I regret? And as I prayerfully, together with Jesus, reflect on my day, I find that it helps me to realize that the journeying in truth and with God is good. It again and again reinforces that when I'm walking with Jesus and when I'm living in obedience to the truths of Jesus, that is when I am truly happy. Every evening, that gets reinforced. And then as I wake up the next day, or even as I fall asleep that day, my mind is already thinking that it is good to line my next day up with Jesus, because that's when I'm truly happy and fulfilled. I hope that makes sense. That moment of dark pleasure didn't line up, and that was not satisfying. It was deceptive. In fact, to cast a shadow over my whole day, let's not do that again. I tell myself that. Or I say, I struggled to say yes to the good at that crossroad. I didn't feel like doing that. I've served enough. I just wanted to be selfish. But when I said yes to the good, to what was from above, instead of from what was coming from below, then I found joy, and I was glad I did. Let's do more of that. And so, my brothers and sisters, in that survey that Cider and other people have done, the sense that we're really not living that differently than our neighbors, in that same survey, there was some good news. And the survey right at the end, in this article by Cider about a decade ago, they also discovered that most Christians said that if they knew that they could change and if they knew how to change, they would. That there was a desire in people, in us, to be transformed into the image of Christ. And so I believe that you, like me, would like to win that battle that has seemed hopeless. I believe that you do want to conquer the anger, the anxiety, the critical spirit. And I speak to you today with hope, because as I have been, more intentionally, even in the last years, living in the truth of Colossians chapters 1, 2, and 3, little by little, step by step, some change continues to happen. And that is good for the kingdom of God and for my dear wife, Arlene. Amen. Oh, nah, I'll leave it there.
heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Amen. Here's a verse that I'd like to close with from 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4 and 5. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. May that be your journey and experience this week. Taking captive every thought. When you are at that crossroads and making it obedient to Christ, always bending towards Christ and your true self and not giving in to those things that would be false and would lead to a false self. Now may God bless you. May God keep you. May the very face of God shine on you and be gracious to you. May God's very presence embrace you this week, and may He always be our peace. Amen. Let us go to love and to serve our great God, even as we love and serve one another. Amen.